Hi, Dr. Hussey. How are you doing today?
Pretty good. Thanks for having me on.
Yes, thank you for being here. I'm so excited to chat with you about the evolution of the human diet and your book, actually, that you ran about it, right? Is that what the main focus of it is?
Yeah. I mean, it focuses on diet, but just the evolution of humans and the mismatch between what we evolved to be and what we're living in now.
That's really cool. And then we're also talking about animal products, which is all the fun stuff I love to talk about. So before we get started, though, introduce yourself, who you are and what you do.
I'm Dr. Stephen Hussey. I'm a chiropractor and functional medicine and practitioner. I also do online health coaching at resourceyourhealth.com. I was kind of led to this whole field by my personal health issues that I've resolved since then. And I like to teach people how to take back control of their health because the only person that's going to care more about your health than you is nobody.
Exactly. Always being your biggest cheerleader.
Exactly.
And I think it's really great too, that we just live where we can like get second opinions and get lab tests and just do these things. And we technically always don't have to be, if we feel like we need more answers, it's there. And there's right. practitioners that are out there that are willing to like dig with you, which I love. Mm-hmm. So tell me what made you want to write about this?
So as I mentioned, I struggled with a lot of inflammatory, health conditions as a child, everything from asthma to chronic hives to I eventually ended up with autoimmune type 1 diabetes, all kinds of inflammatory things, IBS. And so in my journey to heal myself, you know, because I was relying on Western medicine a lot throughout my childhood, and they were helping me kind of manage and maybe mitigate some symptoms and things like that, but nobody was telling me why this happened or what to do about it. And so, you know, I went to get a medical education in chiropractic school and then my master's in functional medicine as well. And that gave me, you know, some answers. It gave me a very good background of what I wanted to know or how to approach things. But it still didn't give me all the answers as to why this was happening. And so I am an ever curious person. So I just kept looking and kept looking and eventually stumbled upon evolution and many other things, but mainly evolution. And it really gave me the answers that I needed as for why my body had this reaction to the environment that it was in. And then also it kind of led me to what I could do about it. And so I wanted to put it down, kind of my story and my theory and what I found and share that with the world.
That's awesome. Me too. I can be forever. I guess we all are naturally forever a student, but I feel like me, I just always am looking for what, why, like mm-hmm. I will keep peeling back the layers until there are no more layers. So tell us a little about the basics of the evolution of the human diet. Like what have you found with your
So, and it expands more into diet too, but or more than just diet. I think that there's four basic things about evolution that I like to point out, that things that when I learned about it really kind of gave me the direction I wanted to go, gave me the answers I wanted. And so one is just the concept of natural selection. So at first, you know, I thought it was, it's impossible. It would be impossible for any living thing to change its characteristics to better suit its environment. That's just not possible. And that's because it's not possible with, you know, an individual alive today can't physically change itself. But natural selection and evolution happens over generations. So like just a very basic example of how this happens is like if we have a bunch of tall people and then all of a sudden, or if we have a bunch of tall people and short people, and then all of a sudden the only food available was food high in the trees and the short people decided not to share with the tall people decided not to share with the short people. Now the tall people have an evolutionary advantage because they have the nutrition they need and they're more likely to pass on their genes. And eventually more of those tall people genes get passed on and we have a whole generation of tall people and the short people are gone. So that's just a very basic understanding of how it works, but it happens over generations. The second thing is that many people think that humans evolved from apes, or many people think that they didn't evolve from apes. But what really happened was that human and apes came from a common ancestor. And so we split from that common ancestor about 6 million years ago. And so the different things that happened when that split happened, different things happened to those what would eventually become apes, and different things happened to the beings that would eventually become humans. And what happened during those times is what made us different. And so looking at what made us different and made us modern humans today is very important when we're trying to determine what we should be doing for our health these days, okay? And so the second aspect of that is that we're still susceptible to evolution. And I think a great example of this is that people of minority descent tend to have chronic diseases like metabolic syndrome and diabetes much more severely and much more readily than people of European descent. And I think that is because people in Europe were eating these highly processed and bad for us foods sooner than these other people's ancestors were. And so we had, as people of European descent, had, I guess, a little bit longer to adapt to that because there wasn't Western medicine around that time to keep these people alive. So people who had a poor reaction to that died off. So we got a little more resilient to those foods and that lifestyle. And then you take people of like African descent or Pacific Islander descent and you plump them right into Western society with this Western food, and their ancestors had never eaten that. So of course they get these diseases more severely, right? The third thing is that evolution takes a very, very long time. Dmitry Belyov is a Russian scientist who has shown that it takes at least 30 generations. And he did this in experiments with foxes, and he selectively bred them for domestic traits and found that it took at least 30 generations to see any type of change at all. And then when we got the 50 generations, they basically had these foxes that acted like dogs. But I mean, I don't even know what my great-grandfather, great-great-grandfather looked like, and that was four generations ago. So 30 and then 50 is just an enormous amount of time. And that's with very select breeding too. Like, it doesn't happen that way normally, like in nature, it's very random. So it takes even longer than that. And so because evolution takes a long time, that leads us to the fourth point, is that if the environment around any given individual species changes too quickly, then there's no way that that species could have the necessary generations it needed to adapt to that new environment. And so a good example of this is, you know, the dinosaurs. Some catastrophic event happened that changed their environment too quickly, and it killed them because they couldn't live in that environment.
I swear we still have dinosaurs. They're just lizards now.
Maybe.
Or iguanas. Or alligators even.
And as far as humans go, applying that to us, like the changes that we've experienced in the last, you know, especially 10 to 12,000 years, have changed our environment in a way that it's not too quickly that we're going to die off, but it's changed it in a way that we can't, we've had trouble adapting to that new environment. And so we're seeing the repercussions of that in our health disease epidemic. So that's my theories of evolution that explain why we're having chronic disease today.
Wow. I never would have even really thought that far deep into it, but hey, that's amazing. Cause it does, it makes you like think about everything in a different light. That would have never really put it two and two together. And then what about our diet? Like, what have you seen from a diet perspective? I mean, geez. Yeah. I guess there's centuries and centuries, but I feel like our generation has gone through so much. What, like, processed foods came in the 70s ish maybe even the 60s, and I feel like we've done it so fast. So much has changed in the food industry in like 50 years.
So it's kind of, we get these closer and closer together major changes. So like the first one was 10 to 12,000 years ago, it's estimated around that time when humans went from living out in the wild to, you know, farming in industrial, or not industrial, but in civilizations. And that was a major change in our diet, because now we're relying a lot more on, you know, grains and carbohydrate rich foods, things that, you know, maybe we ate a little bit of before, but now it was like the staple of our diet. And so that was a big change. But then, you know, we get more and more advanced civilizations, and then we get the Industrial Revolution, which is only about 200 to 300 years ago, that really changed the way we eat and live. And so now we have these foods that were already more carbohydrate rich and more, a little bit more nutrient poor, and now we process them a lot to increase their shelf life and to create large quantities of them. And so when that happened, we start to see declines in health, mainly because we're not getting nutrition. We're eating these processed foods that are void of nutrition. And then you talk about, between 1950s and 70s, we have the whole fat is bad type of thing. You know, 1950s, Ansel Keys came out and said that it was associated with heart attacks and heart disease, which was totally false. And he cherry picked his data to get that result. But yeah. then that led us to stray away from fat, which is one of the most nutrient dense things we can do, or the most nutrient, the highest quality calories we can get. And we start going toward, you know, like 100% toward this whole empty calorie, processed food, high carbohydrate diet that is the standard American diet. And so those things started happening, and they're happening, you know, with less and less time between them. And so that just created this monumental change that there's no way we could have adapted to.
Yeah. Yeah. I always love the saying, overfed and undernourished, because that's totally just how we are now. And it's so sad. It's so funny because, like, when you talk to someone about nutrition, I mean, it's not rocket science. I think everyone knows, like, kind of what to do, but then I think just the food industry is so confusing with the marketing. Marketing is, like, fantastic, where they make everything feel like, oh, this is nutrient dense, even though it's, like, processed, but, like, you can get it. And then when you look at, like, the ingredients, you're like, oh my gosh, like, how is that? Okay, so I feel like marketing has gotten phenomenal, because I feel like now people are just confused as ever, even though, I mean, it's really simple to go back to the basics, but I feel like we're so far off because we're used to just relying on quick foods that all you have to do is heat up or whatnot, or we're like losing like our cooking ability.
Exactly,
just real food.
Yeah. So people don't know what to do with food, you know?
That scares me, thinking of like, okay, 30 generations from now, where are we going to be?
Yeah.
Like back to like the Back to the Future movie where it's like little pizza and then Mike's in.
Yeah. And like, well, I mean, we're getting there. I mean, we're getting to, the, you know, where they're making like fake meat, and they're making, you know, have you ever seen the movie Wall-E where they're drinking their food from a cup when they're living up in space? And like their breakfast comes in a cup, their lunch comes in a cup, and they just drink it. And I've even, you know, seen all these companies that are making like it's supposed to be like all the nutrition you need in one smoothie in the morning or something like that. And I mean, it may have all the nutrients you need, like technically, but I just think there's something about food that we have evolved to consume this thing that is food and not synthetic nutrients from a powder, that kind of thing. Yes. I think there's more to it than we think. And we can try and just replace nutrients. But I think that food and whole unprocessed food is what we evolved to eat. And if we didn't give ourselves, maybe if we gave ourselves, you know, the time, we did it very, very slowly, we could evolve to eat these powdered things. But I don't know that we would ever organize ourselves enough to do that. And so currently right now, we have to look back. We have to look at what we were eating before and try and recreate that in the modern world, because my genes are not going to change. Your genes are not going to change. Like our characteristics are not going to change. Our physiology is not going to change. That happens over generations. So we have to look at where that physiology, what type of environment that physiology evolved in.
Yes, definitely. I know one of the companies that I kind of picked through with the direct sales, I kind of wanted to start doing that because I get so many questions of like, is this powder, is supplement good? And I'm always like, no. Anyway, so Juice Plus was one of them. And I know that they have their like fruit and veggie capsules, whether it's gummy or whatever. And it was really easy for people. And I will say they have studies. They have studies that show that it actually does increase your antioxidants or whatever in your body. But it's like, I think that's really easy to start to rely on, because you're like, oh, well, I'm just getting enough in this supplement. And then, you know, they don't, well, I mean, I'm sure some of them do, but it's easy to be like, oh, I can have this, like this processed food, because I'm taking the supplement and I'm kind of getting my daily value there, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so it's a very slippery slope once you kind of get started on that route. Yeah. And so I love that you emphasize animal products, because I also believe that they are so nutrient dense and some of the most bioavailable sources of certain nutrients. And so I'm not a fan of the vegan diet personally, and I'm not a fan of the vegan diet for any clients that come in either. Especially because clinically I see a lot of nutrient deficiencies. I see a lot of inflammation. And when I test food sensitivities, it's funny because some of the food sensitivities they have are like with the grains, like rice and oats, and then they're like, what do I eat? So I would love to hear your point of why animal products don't cause heart issues, which is so crazy that that's still a thought, but I understand that everyone's nerdy as me and like with the times, but a lot of people are still nervous of the whole cholesterol thing and all that. So I would love to hear
Yeah. Well, I mean, we'll start kind of back at the beginning. So when I talked about that split we had from apes, you know, that common ancestor that wasn't chimps or bonobos like we see today, and it wasn't modern humans, it was something else, you know, and we split from that. And so, like I was saying, what happened on the path that we took, or like our ancestors took, is what made us human. And so if we look at one of the major things that differentiates us on the path that, you know, the path that led them to become chimps, bonobos, and orangutans, and the path that led us to be modern humans, is it was diet. So they continued to eat, and their ancestors continued to eat, you know, lots of leaves, lots of fruit. You know, they had these, you know, big guts that could ferment and digest everything they needed from that. Whereas our ancestors started incorporating more animal foods. And so then natural selection came into play. And so the ones of those species that were more able to utilize the nutrients from that food were the ones that got to pass on their genes. And so eventually it became like we were eating a lot of animal foods and plants, and definitely in times of scarcity. And when things were in season, we were eating those plant foods as well. But the ability of us to, or of our ancestors to eat meat and fat and big fatty animals is what made us human today. Because some people say, oh, we evolved to eat meat. It's like, no, we evolved to be humans because we ate meat and because we ate animal products. And so to me, the philosophical underlying of that is that if this food is what made us who we are today, and there's plenty of archaeological evidence that shows that, then how could it possibly be causing heart disease, you know? Especially if heart disease is only this epidemic of the last, you know, 150 to 200 years, if that, it may be just, you know, 100 years old. So that's the big underlying, you know, doubting question. But then if we fast forward and we look at, you know, so I mentioned Ansel Keys, and what he did in the 1950s was he took data available from six different countries. And it was data that showed the amount of saturated fat and cholesterol that these countries ate, and then the amount of heart disease that they had. And so he found this correlation between cholesterol and saturated fat and heart disease. But what he did was there was data at the time from 22 different countries, and he picked the six that he thought would give him the highest correlation. And then later he repeated the study, and he did it with seven countries. And so then I think it was like maybe 3 years later or so, there was a New York statistician, he worked for the government in New York, and a UC Berkeley statistician that redid the study and included all the data from all 22 countries. And there was absolutely no correlation. They found no correlation. And so that was debunked there, but Ansel Keys was a very charismatic guy, I guess. And he kind of pushed this through. He may have had some financial backing from, you know, corn and wheat industry. I don't know. That's just speculation, but he got the point across, and now that's kind of what stuck.
Yes.
So that's the idea that we have, you know, and it's just this thing that people can't get over.
Yeah. Well, I feel like I guess not. I was about to say, I feel like now we know correlation does not equal causation, but then I lie, because then I'm like, there was just an egg study that came out that just said, like, you eat, I don't know how many eggs a day, three or more a day or something, and you'll like have heart disease or whatever.
Yeah. Well, and then lots of these studies.
Oh my gosh.
They're epidemiology. So it's basically just comparing things and saying, like, okay, these people eat a lot of saturated fat and cholesterol, therefore it causes heart disease. But it's like, okay, and these
there's
people
so much other stuff.
Right. There's so many other variables that could play in that. And so you have this healthy user bias. So you have these people who are usually eating more saturated fat and cholesterol are the ones who don't care about their health. They're not listening to what's being recommended, even though what's being recommended is wrong. They're not listening to it. So they're also doing other unhealthy behaviors like smoking and drinking, and they don't care about your health. Whereas people who are trying to limit that are the people that are listening to health advice, even though it's wrong. And so they're doing other healthy behaviors. They're exercising, they're avoiding toxins. You know, they're doing all these, that they're not smoking and drinking. And so to draw those conclusions from epidemiology like that, it's just, we can't do that. We can't base health recommendations on that. But there's more than just that. I mean, there's so many systematic reviews where they review all the literature of the last, you know, however many years they decide to review, that show there's no correlation between saturated fat, cholesterol in the diet, and heart disease. Mm-hmm. And there's research that shows that the LDL molecule, which is the quote unquote bad cholesterol, which there's no such thing as bad cholesterol, is not associated with increased heart attacks or heart disease. And there's studies that show, especially in the elderly, that people with higher cholesterol levels, or at least normal to higher, live longer.
Mm-hmm.
There's studies that show that people who have low cholesterol or not optimal levels of cholesterol have all kinds of ailments, especially these neurodegenerative diseases that we yes. see. So the modern day science does just not back up what Ansel Keys said. And so if we look at, you know, our evolutionary history compared with the modern science, that's not backing up what Ansel Keys said. We have this kind of dent in our history that was this cholesterol theory of heart disease that's in the middle of it and just kind of wedging itself in there. And it's really hard to let go of. And so we have to stop being scared of a saturated fat and of yeah. cholesterol and realize that it's actually a necessary molecule for our bodies.
It's so needed. I just don't think people realize that cholesterol is needed to make our hormones. And mm-hmm. it's like, without hormones, I mean, what are we? No, I'm just kidding. But seriously, it's that big of a deal. And so I even see, yeah, people like, I personally prefer cholesterol like around like 180, just like, again, the high, I guess the high normal. Mm-hmm. I think that's a great place to be at. But when people are like 150, you know, they're 140. And I'm like, that, I mean, even textbooks I had going through school, my undergraduate, it was saying like, okay, now you're getting to a level of, okay, there might be issues. Like now you're going to have issues because you don't have enough cholesterol.
Yeah. And so like everybody focuses on LDL and like, that's the evil one. You have to make sure it's low, but it's really, it's only a problem in the context of your entire blood work. Yes. So if you look at the LDL molecule, and let's say even if it was super high, if it was like in the 200s, like I wouldn't necessarily care unless other markers were elevated too. So if right. we have, you know, the combination of high LDL with high triglycerides and low HDL, that's a problem.
Right.
Because now we're and like high inflammatory markers. Now this person is that LDL, which is the molecule that's most associated with getting deposited in an artery, it's being allowed to do that because these other markers are off. But if your LDL is high, it's actually that's the amount of cholesterol that your body's saying it needs right now to do things like make hormones and feed your brain and all these different things and nourish your nervous system. But if the HDL is high, triglycerides are low, and then LDL is high, that's fine. We have low markers of inflammation, low insulin resistance, all that stuff is perfectly okay. And I would not even worry about the LDL number. I'd actually be like, that's great that it's that level, you know?
Yeah.
So it's think, really the big context.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think too, with LDL, I think it's just more to the picture as well. I know that something that I've heard, I'm pretty sure it was from Chris Kresser, and he was talking about how we should think of cholesterol like as passengers in a car. Mm-hmm. And we're just like focusing on the wrong part of it. Like we're so focused on just cholesterol when like there's different sizes of LDL particles, there's oxidation in the LDL particles, which honestly is more studied with increasing risk, which is kind of like anything. Cause once something's, you know, has that oxidative stress, it does increase the risk of other things. So, a lot of the times, like our basic blood work that we're just getting, we're not even looking at that. Like that's not what normally is tested unless you have like a really in-depth heart lab that was taken.
Right. Yeah. Like, I mean, these days you go, most of the doctors just take your cholesterol panel and they say, oh, your LDL is high, here's a statin. There's no other thought process to why it would be high or any context with the rest of the markers that you see on that blood work.
Yes. Or like I said, even in depth, more in depth. I think the basic cholesterol panel now sucks. I don't think that shows at all what was really going on inside. It's such an incomplete picture.
Yeah. And the other thing is that cholesterol doesn't really cause heart disease. If we're looking at damage to an arterial lining, that's happening because of the breakdown of the layer that protects the endothelia, which is the layer of cells around the artery. But there's a layer of structured water that protects that. And if that breaks down due to oxidative stress, mm-hmm. then the oxidative stress, the free radicals can actually damage the lining of the artery. And the body doesn't want that. And so what it does is it takes the best thing it has available. So it takes some cholesterol, it takes some minerals like calcium, phosphorus, things like that, puts them together and makes like this spackle kind of thing and puts it on the side of the artery to protect it from fully rupturing.
The Band-Aid.
Exactly. So the moral of the story there is that the cholesterol is actually
helping
us at that point. You know, it's helping us not die pretty much from a ruptured artery.
Yeah.
So it's not the cholesterol is not causing the disease, but the presence of it in the blood is not causing the disease. It's only when we get that damage from oxidative stress, which happens from, you know, high carbohydrate diets, toxins, mm-hmm. Psychological stress, those types of things.
That's what I'm saying. It's just like, yeah, we're saying, okay, let's examine the Band-Aid. The Band-Aid's not the problem. Mm-hmm. It's helping, like you said, it's helping us. But mm-hmm. what is causing more Band-Aids to be put on and really like starting to create this clog in the arteries?
Yeah. I heard this great analogy that was like, let's say that you're driving down the highway and you see an accident on the side of the road. And it's kind of a big accident. It's kind of coming out into the road a little bit. But nobody comes by. So that's like the Band-Aid. That's the damage that happened and the cholesterol gets put on there. But then nobody comes by to clean up the accident. And traffic keeps flowing. And, you know, we've all, you know, even just a little fender bender, everybody slows down, you know, and everybody watches it. And you're like, oh, it must be a huge traffic jam. And you get by it and it was just like a car on the side of the road. It's all it mm-hmm. was. You know, and so that happened. Things slow down or other cars, you know, maybe don't see it that one day and they hit it and another car piles up and another car piles up. And so eventually it becomes this big thing. That's kind of an analogy. That's kind of how it works. Like we get a little bit of repaired damage in the artery. And then as other things are flowing by, it can kind of accumulate.
Definitely.
Yeah,
definitely. So where do you feel like other animal, with animal products, what are some other benefits that we're getting from it? I mean, outside of it shouldn't cause, you know, reasons for heart disease, but I mean, let's talk real quick about, you know, animal products versus plants in the sense of nutrients, in the sense of bioavailability with each mm-hmm. thing, because I know there are things we cannot get from plants. I don't care what you say, you have to start relying on a supplement. And I say, when your diet forces you to rely on a supplement, I think there's an issue with that.
Yeah, exactly. And I think, the number one is B12. I mean, we can't get that from plants. And people say that, oh, your bacteria in your gut make B12. And it's just like, yeah, but it's not really enough to you know, stop the damage from not having B12 happening. But B12 is only available in animals. But there's so many others. If we're talking about omega-3s, and yes. the amount that we need of that, because we can get, you know, like omega-3s from algae and things, but it's just like we need high bioavailable sources of that. And so we need to be able to extract it from the food. And lots of times with plants, they're bound to cellulose, which is a little harder for us to digest. We can still get lots of nutrients from them, but it's hard to extract everything from them. And so we need very bioavailable sources of some nutrients, and omega-3s is one of them. But also just B vitamins, enough of them in general. We need, egg yolks, grass-fed beef liver are just full of B vitamins in their most bioavailable form. Mm-hmm. So that's just going to allow us to have optimal levels, you know?
Yes.
And then I think another big one is collagen protein. I think that, you know, our ancestors would have, you know, been eating as much of the animal as they could, which is why the organ meats and things like making bone broth and stuff is good, because we need that collagen. Because the reason we need the collagen is because research has shown that when we get this glycine, methionine imbalance, we get too much methionine, which we get mm-hmm. in red meat and things like that, that can cause issues. Whereas when we balance it with glycine, which we find in collagen protein, which is the connective tissue, not the muscle meat, then we see a much healthier outlook. And the other thing is that glycine is one of the building blocks for our main antioxidants that our body produces itself, glutathione and superoxide dismutase. So getting those glycine ratios or those methionine glycine ratios in balance is really important. And you can't get collagen anywhere in a plant.
Yes.
So we need to include these animal products in our diet.
Yes. And I think people too, I think vitamin A is a great example, because people think they can get like vitamin A from like sweet peas and carrots, which is like in the source of beta carotene, but the conversion rate is so low in humans that I don't consider sweet potatoes being the great source of vitamin A. You're going to get it from animals.
Right.
Same with like the omega-3s, like you said, people think like there's omega-3s in flax seeds and chia seeds, which they do, but it's a different kind. And again, the conversion rate in humans are so low. So I do see a lot clinically of omega-3 deficiencies with people that are on like vegetarian.
Yeah. I mean, you mentioned the fat soluble vitamins, which is great. I can't believe I forgot those, but like vitamin K is essential. I mean, that's what Weston Price discovered, was the difference between healthy indigenous populations and unhealthy ones. To me, this epidemic of atherosclerosis is mainly being driven, or not mainly, but contributed to significantly by the fact that we're vitamin K2 deficient, because people aren't eating enough of the right animal products, where they're eating, you know, egg yolks, but the egg yolks were fed, you know, this terrible diet, and they're not full of vitamin K2 like they should be, because the vitamin K2 is what takes minerals and deposits them in the bone where they need to be. So if we don't have that, the minerals get left other places. So we start to see calcification of arteries and tissues and different types of things. And so we need that vitamin K2 for sure.
Yes. And everyone that doesn't know, like spinach and stuff has vitamin K, but vitamin K1.
Exactly.
Again, it's very different in the different plants and animals. So, I mean, I am definitely not a person that jumps to like the latest trending thing or like the most severe on either side, I guess. I do believe that there's a balanced approach, and, you know, I think that there's a place, again, depending on the individual, because still some people just don't do well on grains. And then some people, and I do believe that some of it's also like, you know, what your genes are and like where you're from. So I'm Asian. Well, I'm half Filipino. So I feel like naturally I would probably be more able to digest rice than someone that isn't in that, doesn't have an Asian culture like background. Mm-hmm. So I think that plays a role too, but that's why I'm a huge fan of like food sensitivities, because it's fascinating when I see people that are sensitive to like spinach or rice or quinoa or even salmon. I mean, it's so different for everyone and like what actually inflames them. But another thing that nutrient that probably is very different is the iron. I know people are like terrified of like heme iron. I don't know why, when it's like so needed.
I don't know either. I think that, I mean, the big thing there is that, you know, in animal foods, iron is just more bioavailable. And when we look at, when we look at some of these plant foods, like the grains, they have a lot of phytic acid in them, which will bind up a lot of different minerals and metals and things we need to absorb more of. And so if you're eating, you know, a big steak, that's great. You're getting good iron and you shouldn't be scared of heme iron, but you're getting a lot of this iron. But if you're eating that with a bunch of grains, you're probably not absorbing all of it that you could. And so it's interesting to me to think that we've studied all these RDAs and like the recommended daily allowances of all these different foods in the context of some of these anti-nutrients. And so how do we know that, is this the really the amount we need, or is it the amount we need to get enough with the anti-nutrients in there, like interfering with absorption? I don't know. But I think that when we're eating more bioavailable forms of things, we're going to get optimal levels of these things, regardless of what the, you know, the science says the RDA is.
Totally. And that's why I feel like animal products really thrive, because they don't have like what legumes and grains have. But I will say too, that our ants, I mean, if you look back at like what, you know, our ancestors ate and stuff, they did, I mean, again, depending on where you were in the country or in the world, but they ate it, but they also prepared foods way differently than we do now. So we're very like instant, ASAP, like get me the rice cooked ASAP, when they did more of soaking and sprouting and doing these to where it reduces the amounts of phytic acid. And
yeah, for sure. I mean, and they had to. They knew that if they ate those foods, because, you know, way back in the day, like even you know, past the time of the industrial or the agricultural revolution, life was difficult. And if you were putting foods in your body that made you weak or that didn't give you the nutrients you needed, you were sacrificing. You know, that was a risk, because if you weren't functioning optimally, the next thing that came out of the bush and tried to eat you could be the end of you. And so they were very focused on only eating things. And so then eating things that, you know, made them thrive. And so, you know, if we had to eat these foods, which we did, we had to make them the least harmful to us, you know? So there's all these methods of soaking, sprouting, fermenting, all that kind of stuff that they were doing to make these foods, make the nutrients more bioavailable, decrease the amount of anti-nutrients, things like that.
Yeah, easier to digest for sure.
Yeah.
But no, none of that steers me from loving a good grass-fed steak or I personally, and I think it's actually my whole family, I feel like we love meat and I feel like we feel our best. And even I can feel it even in days, I feel like if we're busy and on the go and I just don't get a good meal with a good protein source, I'm always hungry. I just don't feel well. And I just feel like I could never like not have it. Definitely would not be living my optimal.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
Cool. So where can we find you? Where can we get your book? Tell us.
Yeah. So my website is resourceyourhealth.com and, there's a lot of information on there. My blog is on there. My books are up on there, but you can find those on Amazon. My books are The Health Evolution, Why Understanding Evolution is a Key to Vibrant Health. And I also wrote another shorter ebook called The Heart, Our Most Medically Misunderstood Organ, that goes into my theories of heart disease and heart attacks. But I'm also on social media. I do mainly Instagram and Facebook, but I am on Twitter a little bit. I'm not a huge fan. I mean, I tend to focus on the other ones. But it's Dr. Stephen Hussey, Dr. Stephen Hussey. And that's Stephen with a PH. So they can find me there.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for coming on today.
Yeah, thanks for having me.